He prayed in the garden, Father, take this cup from me. But your will be done, I'll drink it all and die on Calvary. With clubs and swords they came to him, and Judas showed him to them. In chains they took him to Pilate, so that Christ they could condemn. When he gave up the ghost to the heavenly host, the curtain was torn in two. They took him from the cross, Joseph laid him in a tomb. For 3 long days, history was made, and Christ, he was set free. He ascended into the heavens, and it was all for you and me. For you and me, he died on Calvary. For you and me, his blood was shed, so our sins no longer would be. A crown of thorns, nail-scarred hands and feet, a spear in his side for all to see. And all of this he did for you and me. Yes, and all of this he did for you and me.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Community Life on this beautiful Sunday morning. My name is Nikki Cruz. I'm the Director of Youth Ministries here, and we are so excited to have you in our family room, or if you're joining us online, we're just happy to have you here. You may have seen some fun things going on outside on the lawn. That is our high school mission team, who has put together an incredible silent auction for you guys to help support their trip to Kentucky this summer, where we'll be working with a local camp and putting on some fun things, working with local churches in the area. And so if you guys want to go check that out after service, it'll be there for you. And we thank you in advance for your support. The second thing I have for you guys is you'll see a video here in a minute talking about Nicaragua and Project Hope. If you are interested in being a part of that mission team, we have 2 upcoming opportunities for families to go on this mission trip. There is an informational meeting after this service upstairs in room 1205, and we'd love to have you. Okay, let's get started. Will you guys stand with me this morning? We're going to pray together the Lord's Prayer to join our hearts. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Father God, we come to you this morning, Lord, thankful for the chance to gather together. God, we ask that your presence would just surround us, Lord, and that we would lay whatever we have been carrying this week, this month, this year. God, we lay it at your feet. Lord, and we bring our hearts before you in worship this morning. Thankful for what it is that you bring us, God, and I ask that you would help us to receive your message with open ears. So, Lord, we love you. Bless this time now. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I'm so glad you guys are here. We got a few great songs this morning about just God's goodness and his activity in our lives. So we encourage you to sing with us and lift your voices high for Jesus.
Here, moving in our midst, This morning that I know that are believing you for miracles, God, that are just struggling with all different sorts of things, Lord, from jobs to finances to family, Lord, to health. Just believing you for answers and a miracle in their lives. So we believe that you stepped down into the darkness. Not only did Jesus come to save us, but we believe that you come so that in this life, Lord, we can put our hope and our trust in you and believe and know that you are going to make a way in every circumstance. We love you so much, and we just give you back this day. We open up our hearts to receive from you this morning. The Lord bless you.
He's for you. He's for you. He's for you.
chorus one more time, but I want to tell you what that means when we're singing that, in case you've never heard this before. It's such a beautiful truth that amen means so be it. It's almost like you're saying, God, we believe it. We're going to have faith, and we're going to stand and believe it, whether we feel it, whether we see it. It doesn't matter. We trust in you alone. So can we just lift our voices up this morning and sing that again? Come on, close your eyes, whatever it is you're believing God for. We sing amen. Joy and hope today. Just that you would flood the hearts that are sad this morning, those hearts that are hurting, that you would just restore, Lord, to us that joy of our salvation, just that peace, that overwhelming peace that only you can give today. We love you. Thank you so much just for your presence in this place as Pastor Scott comes to deliver the word, Lord. We open up our hearts and our minds to receive what you have for us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, everybody, for singing. You can be seated.
Hope everybody's doing good this morning. I want to welcome you and thank you for joining us today at Community Life Church on this stellar Sunday morning. Man, I'm telling you, it's beautiful. So whether you're here with us in person or joining us online, we are so glad just to have this time to join our hearts together. Isn't it funny trying to hear other cultures say the name Scott? You're welcome. I've been messing up other cultures for years. That's how I roll. But thank you for being here today. At Community Life, we love God. We love our neighbor, and we believe that our mission is to connect people to Jesus because we believe that Jesus is the source of life. And when you have the source of life, you want everybody that you know to be connected to that source of life. So if there's something we can do, please let us know, and we'll do what we can to connect you. Now, I've got Micah and Tammy, this is my daughter and my wife, on the stage to tell you about the mission work that we're doing in Nicaragua, just to connect you to this great opportunity and maybe a place that you might go and be a part in international missions. So Project Hope is a group that we work with, and they have this mission outreach in, what is the city? In León, or Leon, depends on if you're, and see, there's that culture thing again. So León, which is where the mission is. And there was a group of children that lived in and around a giant landfill. And their only way to survive was to recycle plastic and to find food and really lived in and around this giant dump. And along comes Project Hope, and they built this wonderful mission place that takes these children from, say, kindergarten, maybe a little younger, through school, and they just prepare them for life. They train them with life skills. They provide them uniforms for school. They teach them the gospel message. They tutor them. They help just to really prepare them for life. And it's an incredible ministry that we are just partnering with. And so this last, maybe 2 weeks ago,
Last weekend,
Tammy and Micah were able to go down on a mission trip, and so they're up here to tell you a little bit about it. And so I don't know, we had questions, but we're already off script. So tell us what you want to know.
That's okay. Micah, why don't you start and tell us what was your favorite part of
getting a chance to go? My favorite part was getting to connect with the kids. I mean, these kids would come after school and they'd all be there and we would play everything from jump rope to volleyball to whatever we could make up. Which was really fun, and the kids learned my name is Mika, and
Mika.
They would save me a
Mika
chair.
Mika and whatever Scott is.
Yeah,
I don't know
right.
That is.
And
yeah.
They'd save me a chair at the tiny table, and they'd be like, Mika, 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 and it was really cool getting to connect with the kids and just, I mean, I ended up sponsoring a kid because I just got to connect with her, and that was really cool for me.
Cool.
Yeah, the connection that you get to make, I think, because this is a different type of trip, and a lot of times in the past, I know you'll go on mission trips, and those are awesome as well, and you go and you can work really hard and build a home, but this type of trip is more of a building relationship, getting to know the kids. You go to the project every single day, you eat lunch with them, you get to talk to them, and even the communication barrier is not a problem. You learn so much. It's just a lot of fun, just building those relationships, getting to hear their stories, and getting to hear the teachers, how they came about Project Hope and what God is doing in their lives. For me, my favorite part is when I was there, I just had this moment where I realized that, and we know this is something we should know, but I think it was just in that moment realizing that God is working and moving around the world. He is always moving. He is always moving. He's always doing miracles. And we often, I know I'm guilty of this, where I get caught up in what's going on in my sphere and what's going on in my world, in my box. And I forget that God is doing these beautiful things. So for me, that was life-changing. And to want to get outside of myself, and I think going on a trip, that's what it does, truly. You get to put yourself in a different culture and diversity and just experience Christ in a really awesome way. So it was life-changing. It was great.
Yeah. And we've been looking for this opportunity to have an international mission trip that didn't cost like $7,000, something that people could jump in. It's still, the price is $2,600, which is still a lot of money, but it's doable for folks, that allows anybody and everybody to be able to go. You can bring a family down there. You can go by yourself. And here's what I would say. If you find yourself stuck, maybe you've lost perspective in this world, I guarantee you this will help you. It will give you the way to be able to just see God at work. We don't go and bring God there. God's there.
Yes.
God's doing what God does, but this gives us the opportunity to really serve and plug in and just excited about it. The place that you would stay has air conditioner, in Jesus' name.
Yes.
That's right. Good food. And you know, I was thinking in the first services we talked about this, many of you have abilities and trades, and that we could set up classes where you could go down there and you could teach the children some of these things that you know, and we would set that up because this is how they prepare them for life and how they get them ready. So
yeah, part of what they do every single day, other than getting the meals that they get, their uniforms stay at the school. They come and they pick up their uniforms so they can go to school and have a safe place. They get snacks there. When they come back from school, they break off into classes, and they actually are taught a trade. They are learning English. English. They're getting tutoring specifically that helps them so that when they graduate, they just have more of an opportunity to go and feed their families and take care of their families in a different way than maybe how they initially started in the world. So it's beautiful to see.
Yep, and so there's 76 students that are right now a part of the project, and you can sponsor them. There's an overall cost if you want to sponsor a child for in its entirety, but then you can also divide it up. And how much is that?
Yeah, sorry, there are 25 students still needing sponsorships.
Okay.
Six of those are brand new. And the way it works is it's $190 to take care of one student per month, and they can break that down. One person can do the whole 190, or they can break that down into five different sponsors. So the lowest sponsorship would be like $38. You could be a part of changing someone's life.
Yeah, so stop by out in the foyer. Darcy will be out there, Darcy and Eli, and they'll tell you more about the mission. But just excited about the things that God is doing, not just here in our community, but around the world. Amen? Will y'all give Tammy and Micah a big round of applause? Are they awesome? I'm kind of partial to them. They're kind of cool. Well, hope everybody's doing good today. A couple quick announcements, actually a lot of announcements, and then we're going to jump into this message that I have been ready to deliver for a while now. So, beach baptisms. If you've not been baptized, the Sunday after Easter, weather permitting, we go down to Navarre Beach and we will baptize you. The water will be freezing, and so you will remember your baptism. It's a great way to do it. It's beautiful. The sun's coming up, and we just have that great moment. If you've not been baptized, this is the best way to do it. If you have been baptized, but maybe this is a time and a season when you want to remember that baptism and just reconnect, we encourage you to do that. You can stop out at the welcome desk on the way out, or you can text CLC Baptism to 94,000, and that'll get you connected. There is an IF gathering that's coming up. Ladies, if you're looking for a way to connect, you can stop on the foyer. I know they have a table. The details of that have slipped my mind, and it's not on my paper. But if you're looking for a way to connect and you want that weekend opportunity, this is it. So make sure you stop by out in the foyer. And then there's one other one. There's a giving announcement. So if you are one of the folks that locked in your giving into the push pay format, which is what we used, Greta has been working through to try and figure out how we can best take care of our resources. And she discovered that if we change giving platforms, she can save $33,000 in the calendar year by moving to a different platform. So if you locked it in the platform of push pay, she will be reaching out to you this week. She'll probably send out an email today and help you to get transitioned over. She will call you and talk you through it on the phone. Some of y'all are freaking out. So she'll help you to get that all transitioned over. And so excited about getting that done. And then this week, church council meets on Wednesday night at 6:00. And we're gonna start this conversation around our affiliation in the United Methodist Church. And then we will carry that to a larger conversation on Sunday the 3rd, as well as Thursday the 7th, where we will have an open forum for an opportunity for people to come in and kind of be a part of this conversation and find out more information. And so we encourage you, if that just really kind of draws your heart in or that interests you, to be a part of those. We're going to have communion at the end of each one of those meetings, because anytime you have conversations that may cause us to get into a room and have to throw some details around and work through that, we want to make sure we end with Christ as the center. Amen? So we invite you to be a part of those conversations. Next week, so August 3rd is next Sunday, so I'll give you more information next Sunday to prepare you for that, but that's on a Sunday and a Thursday, and just to give you a heads up. Okay, well, we're in a series called Journey with Jesus, and you know, I was laughing today as I always try to think about my setup and how many things I do exactly the same, and so a lot of you guys, you probably dial me out until I get to the scripture. You know, the Easter story is kind of the same. Do y'all know that? It's just like Christmas. Every year I get to tell the same story, but I have to figure out a way to re-engage you with that story. And so this series, I think, is doing that. And what we're doing different, if today's your first time here and you've not ever been a part of our church, we're doing something different in this Easter series, that's what it is. We are showing you pictures, actual pictures, of the locations where these events took place. And the hope is that as you read your scripture, when you see this picture, you can always be brought back to a place to maybe understand what it looked like, how the people connected, who were the people, how does Israel and the scope of how it all lays out, how does it work? in terms of what we're reading inside of Scripture. So as we've gone through this, I've heard from a lot of you that you just absolutely love seeing the pictures. Well, let me tell you, in the next couple years, depending on how the world opens up, we're going to be making more trips to Israel, and I encourage you to join us, because the only thing better than looking at a picture is to put your feet on the ground and to be able to experience it. And so we're hoping to do that next year if COVID and all of that stuff works out, but if not, definitely the year after that, and we'll be going back. So keep your eyes open for more details. But showing you the pictures, drawing you into the story. And so in week one, and we're following along in Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew. Week one, we started with the baptism of Jesus. And Jesus was baptized in a place called Bethany beyond the Jordan. So here's your map. Here's the Sea of Galilee. Looks like a, I don't know, a circle with some squiggly lines. But there's the Sea of Galilee. Here's the Mediterranean Sea. The sea out of the Sea of Galilee flows the Jordan River. And here's the Dead Sea below it. Jesus was baptized in a place called Bethany beyond the Jordan, right here, just north of the Dead Sea, but down towards the bottom part of the Jordan River. And the interesting thing about this is the exact location where Moses led the children of Israel up to the edge of the Jordan River. And then Joshua brings them into the Promised Land. This is the exact location where Elijah leaves the Promised Land and is taken up to heaven, and then Elisha comes back in. And so what we discover is this spot, and we have the picture out in the lobby if you want to see it, is where it's like the front door to the Promised Land. And as we went through and studied Scripture, it just brings that story to life, because what we discover is that Matthew takes the Old Testament, to which him was the Testament, he takes those stories and he connects Jesus to the pattern of the old stories. But for Matthew, he's letting you know that as that Old Testament, or as his testament unfolds, Jesus doesn't make the same mistakes. So Jesus follows that same journey, but he's successful in what he does. And so goes through Bethany beyond the Jordan. Then we have the Mount of Temptation, where Jesus was believed in the Judean wilderness to have been tested. And the main part about that sermon is we hear about Jesus going into the wilderness to be tested or tempted. And you think of that as being tempted to do something wrong. But if you understand the Greek word, that means to be proven, like a math equation. He was going into the wilderness not to be tested or to be tempted, but really to be proven to be the Son of God. So as he comes up out of the water and the heavens open up and God says, "This is my Son whom I'm well pleased," he immediately goes into the wilderness and proves it through the three testings that he goes through. And Matthew's part in that is to let you know that Jesus passed every single one of the tests. He is who God says he was. And then last week, Jesus moves from the Judean wilderness. He moves up to the Sea of Galilee, to a little town called Capernaum. And that's where he sets up shop. And 75 to 85% of his ministry unfolds in that area. A span of about 30 miles, this area right here, this whole 30 square miles. For those who want to know, I always forget to tell you this, from the Sea of Galilee to Jerusalem is about 75 miles. So other than their trip to Egypt when Jesus was first born, he spends his entire life in the distance between here and Panama City Beach. So that may give you a little perspective as you're reading Scripture to know the life of Jesus, how much he traveled, and really how little of a distance that he covered in the full scope of his life. So Jesus ministered to those there in Capernaum. Why that's significant is because if you and I were God, first of all, we would really jack everything up. But if you and I were God, we would go about it in a different way. We would send Jesus to Jerusalem first, because that was the center of all things holy. And then we would build an army, and then we would send them out into the world. God starts by sending Jesus up here to the Sea of Galilee to what I would call the least of these. If you read the end of chapter 4, it's those who are sick, epileptics, those who are having seizures, those who are paralytics. In that world and in that culture, if you were sick, you were considered to not have the blessing of God. And people didn't want anything to do with you because you had nothing to offer them. And so you were just cast out. Those are the people that Jesus starts to call his disciples. Those are the ones that start to respond to his voice. And so the very early stages, the beginning part of his ministry, those were the ones he spent time with. Totally reversed of what we would do in our lives. And so that's the group that he's spending time with. Today, we're going to move to the Mount Beautiful, or the Beautiful Mountain. And we're going to talk about the Sermon on the Mount. And this is an interesting spot. You think about mountain. So he goes up on the mountain and he delivers this sermon. Does anybody know, thinking about Matthew and how he wrote this gospel, why would a mountain be important? This is an all skate. You can shout out an answer. Who went up on a mountain to get the law? Abraham went up on a mountain because of God called him to go up there and sacrifice his son. Elijah goes up on a mountain too. Mountains are very significant to being a place where you go to encounter God, the Mount of Transfiguration. So Matthew is drawing this parallel now to the message that he's going to preach. It connects, once again, to what we read in the Old Testament, but now this is Jesus and his moment to start to speak into what that word, what that law, what that's going to look like. So a mountain is very important. So we have a few pictures for you to look at, and so we're going to go ahead and put the first one up. This is actually the hill. Don't say mountain, say hill. If you're from out west, this is going to be wildly disappointing for you. The peak of this mountain, Mount Beautiful, is 200 feet below sea level. I don't know how that works out, but that's just the topography from over there. But this is the hill, and you can kind of see how it goes down. There's just a natural amphitheater. You could sit right over here next to this rock, and you could put someone down at the bottom of that hill, and you could talk to them, and they could hear you plain as day. Didn't need a sound system. Jesus figured out how to use topography to get the message out. Let's go on and go to the... Oh, actually, hold on, stay right there. If you pan this camera a little bit to the left, there's a giant church right there. Why is the church not in there? I get frustrated about it sometimes because every time there's something significant that happens, we build a church. I don't know why that is. So here's this beautiful hill where Jesus sat outside in nature and proclaimed the message, and we decided that it needed a building. And so that's what they dropped there. So if you ever go, if you go home and you search the beautiful mountain or Mount Beautiful, you're going to find a giant church. Has nothing to do other than that's where they celebrate. I don't want to say anything. Before I offend everybody on the planet, there's a big building there. Okay, so here's the next picture. As we were traveling through, we couldn't get down to that spot. And so here's Scott standing on a mountain hill. And I'm getting ready. I'm kind of talking about the setting and go ahead and go to the next picture. Then I got out the Bible and I actually read the Beatitudes to the group that was there. And so we're going to go ahead and push play on it. There's a short video. You don't necessarily have to hear it. But just imagine, see how the topography, how it goes down, how you could gather in different spaces. The Sea of Galilee is over to the right. And what's so interesting is as we were here, I finished reading, and you see this road over here on the left? A giant 18-wheeler comes around that corner. And I mean, I thought, well, Jesus didn't have to deal with that. So I thought I was doing pretty special. But anyways, he had to deal with people trying to kill him. So anyways, isn't that interesting, kind of see the lay of the land? I got two more pictures for you. These are not of that hill, but they'll set the stage for you when you think about the sermon that we're going to read where Jesus says, you are salt and light. You don't light a light and then put it under a basket. It's a city set on a hill, cannot be hidden. And so go ahead and go to the next picture. We have this awesome opportunity. They couldn't schedule us on the Jesus boat during the day, so they scheduled it at night. And so we get on this boat, and we're driving, and you would say, man, that's a real nice deck. You know what that is? That's a dance floor. And there's a Palestinian DJ. He's got his cool little DJ booth, and they know all of the cool Christian songs. And they start to turn them on. And all the Christians get up and dance as you're out on the Sea of Galilee moving around. We're just all tired. You can tell we're whipped as they're telling us some stories. But look off in the distance. That, and go ahead and go to the next picture. That is Magdala. But so where Mary Magdalene is from, but really it's the city beyond it. So Tiberias is coming into view. And right down here in the front is where in antiquity is where Magdala would have been. And I tell you, these people that Jesus was preaching to, they would have understood when he said, a city set on a hill cannot be hidden, when he's talking about light, because as they were on the Sea of Galilee at nighttime, they would have been able to tell where they were going, what they were doing. And it brings the story to life. And I hope someday we're all sitting on that boat, dancing our way down through the Sea of Galilee, enjoying that time. Do the pictures help a little bit? There's not as many good ones of this one. I promise when we get to Jerusalem next week, you're going to get some better pictures. But anyways, hopefully they'll help. Okay, let's talk about the Sermon on the Mount, and then we're going to cover three chapters of Matthew. So get ready. Anytime in my mind, I think about trying to preach through the Sermon on the Mount, It's number one, it's a daunting task, and number two, it's a impossible task, because Jesus is kind of the Son of God, right? Like totally the Son of God, and so his message would have been pretty good. You agree? So as a preacher, to try and preach the Sermon on the Mount is a little ridiculous. So I'm going to attempt to take the words of Jesus and maybe decipher them a little bit so that we can understand what he's doing in the Sermon on the Mount. But I encourage you later today to go home or this week And just sit down and read through these three chapters. With some of the keys that I'm going to give you today, I think you'll be able to understand the words a little better, because the Sermon on the Mount can seem impossible for us in our faith to live into. So I'm going to give you a key or two today that that will help to understand it. So let's dive into it and just see where we can get to. So Matthew chapter 5 says, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he began to speak and taught them, saying. Now, interesting point of fact. At this point in Matthew, Matthew has only told us about four disciples. He called them last week. We talked about it. Four fishermen. So many people, when they teach this, you have in your mindset Jesus' disciples that were there. What I need you to know is that Jesus' disciples are the ones who are responding to his call. So yes, it's the disciples that ultimately become the apostles, but anyone who's under discipline or growing in their faith or hearing the message and growing in it or following, those are disciples. So just for your imagination, think for a moment of who he's delivering this message to. In front of him are honestly the least of these in society of the day. The ones that have responded to his call would have been those that society would have thrown away and would not have been considered blessed by any standards. And yet these are the ones that Jesus gathers with on a hillside to start to proclaim and to talk about this kingdom and how it's going to be different. So just hold on to that. I think sometimes we try to polish up what Jesus is doing. He would have been surrounded by people that even in today's standards, we might think that there's not much that they can accomplish, that maybe they don't have anything to offer. That's where Jesus starts. Yes, he does. And so if you feel like yourself as one of the least of these, you're right there in the mix of what Jesus is doing. And he does something so amazing. So here he is surrounded by these folks. And he does what many rabbis do when they preach, but this doesn't seem to make sense. He starts off by blessing them. The least blessed people on the planet, he starts off by delivering the Beatitudes, and he blesses every single one of them that's in front of them. For many of these people, this is the first and only blessing they will have ever heard in their life. Now, that to me seems like the heart of God that we know, that God is loving people that have never been loved before. They have been told that God has abandoned them and that God doesn't care about them, and what Jesus does is he starts off by blessing them. And he delivers the Beatitudes, but what you hear when you read through the Beatitudes is that this is an awareness of a gospel, or this blessing is something that's upside down, because listen to the Beatitudes and how backwards they are. Doesn't seem like somebody who had these instances would be blessed. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. In our minds, we think of somebody that's poor, we don't necessarily think of them as blessed. So somebody who's poor in spirit, that really doesn't seem like somebody who'd be blessed. Except Jesus is speaking to a higher awareness. When you become aware of your place in light of God, and that you need God in your life, and that you can't make it without God, then you realize that you are poor in spirit and you desire God, you want God. So blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. When you recognize that you need God and you can't do it yourself, you're poor in spirit, and you are blessed. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. When you realize that you are setting your life aside for the life that God is going to give you, then you mourn that old way of living. Doesn't seem like anybody that would be mourning would be blessed. But you see the pattern of life that Jesus is elevating to being this gospel message. Blessed are the meek. The meek in this society would have been run over by Rome. They'd been run over by the ruling class. But meekness is to allow somebody else their way, to say, God, you give me life, to yield my life for the life you give me. And he says, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst. I'm going to tell you, people who are hungry and thirsty, they don't usually feel very blessed. Some of y'all are planning your after church meals, and you'd be glad, you'd be blessed if the preacher let you go right now. But think about it. If he said to them, blessed are those who hunger and thirst, they're out there and they're like, man, I do not feel blessed. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. For those who truly have a heart after pursuing God. You guys see the level of the Beatitudes and what Jesus is presenting to them? He starts to talk about the outfacing. Blessed are the merciful. So in that culture, to show mercy was not something that was admired. because you wanted to be a person of strength. And so blessed are the merciful, blessed are the pure in heart, those who are going to try and work through and discover right relationships. You want things in your heart that represent God. You've gotten that garbage out of there. Blessed are the peacemakers. In this society, we've been blessed are those who make war. Now, this one in particular to me would have been so strange because they're looking for a Messiah that's going to come in and overthrow the Roman world. So to say blessed are the peacemakers, they're like, yeah, don't know what that one means, but yeah, because they're waiting for a battle to happen. But Jesus says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. And blessed are those who persecute you for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Back to that point of righteousness, it starts by talking about those who belong to the kingdom, and it ends by those talking about those who belong to the kingdom. And so Jesus presents this image of this upside down blessing, and it correlates with those that are in front of him because they do not seem like the ones to be blessed, but Jesus invites them in to this larger conversation. And so he's identified these folks, he's blessed them, then he starts in this conversation. And there's a reason why I've called you, and there's a reason why you've been blessed. And he says, it's because you are salt and light. What I'm going to do in your life, what's going to happen through the transformation that you experience, will become salt. You'll flavor life for other people to be attracted. You'll also preserve life because of the transformation that you've experienced. And to be light, you'll be someone who illuminates. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. That when you allow God to transform or to do something special inside of you, people are drawn to you. And so this is the message he's delivering to these people that didn't feel like they had anything to offer in this world. And now Jesus says, you will be salt and light. What God is going to do in you is going to transform the rest of the world. And the rest of this gospel message proves that to be true. It wasn't the religious elite. It was those who you would have thought to be less than that ultimately changed the world. And then we move over into the next part of this. And now we're gonna move quickly through the scripture. So you get to verse 17 all the way down through 20, and I'm gonna read it. But in this text is a key that I think if you can understand this key, then it will unlock for you, not just the Sermon on the Mount, but it will unlock a lot of life for you. Maybe understanding how God views you and is inviting you to live out your life. So he says this, and when I read it, you're gonna be like, what does that have to do with me? Verse 17, he says, do not think I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. Now we're thinking, what does that have to do with anything? But so let me just read on and then I'll come back. Verse 18, for truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. And remember, he just said that he would be the one to fulfill it. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be great, or will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Verse 20, for I tell you, unless your righteousness, this is the one that seems so hard, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. And so now here are these people who have been blessed. They are the least of these. And now Jesus is saying, unless your righteousness exceeds those that are the Pharisees and the scribes, you're not even going to inherit the kingdom of heaven. Those people would have been there like, man, what? Like, how is it possible that I could even live into that? So let me give you the key. When Jesus says, I've come not to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. Do you remember in the Gospel of John? John says, in the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And what ultimately happens to the Word? The Word becomes flesh and dwells amongst us. And so that Word, that Logos, the heart of God, becomes flesh. And here in this same text, what Jesus is telling you is, I have come not to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. The law was intended to be the picture of who God is, how God would live in this world. And so as God looked down at his world, he saw this Jewish faith that had become all about the rules. And in essence, what he did is put flesh on that law. And so what Jesus is the fulfillment of exactly what was spoken, exactly what was said. And so we say, so how is it that God, Jesus never sinned and never made a mistake? Because he is the law, the embodiment of that truth. And so when he walked on this earth, you can hear people teach about the law, or you can look and you can see the representation of God in the flesh, how he cared that it be led out or that it be lived out. That's a key for us as we think about this message. Because in this message, we could talk about obedience. We want everybody to do exactly what it is that Jesus is saying, right? Like, that sounds like a really good message. But what he's about to say here in a message is really gonna screw that up. Because this is more than just obedience. It goes beyond just doing what is told to you. There's an invitation to be transformed by this relationship with God. So if you continue on, this rest of chapter 5, here are the topics that they deal with. Anger, adultery, divorce, oaths or promises, retaliation, and your love for enemies. He brings up these topics that all of us maybe have talked about or wondered about or bumped into, our anger, the things that we deal with in life. And Jesus would start off by saying, you've heard it said this. Well, I tell you this. And now think about that in terms of the key that I just gave you. You've heard the law taught in this way, but let me give you a better understanding of the law. You heard the law taught, don't commit murder. I'm gonna tell you, you shouldn't even be angry with someone else. Right, so we all know people that have not committed murder, let's hope, right? But you also know people that have not committed murder, but they're still jerks, right? Like you can meet these people and they do not look like the image and the personification of God. And so what Jesus is saying is it's not enough to be obedient. It's about the transformation that happens in our lives. Okay, great, so you didn't commit murder, but there's so much more about you that needs to change. I'm telling you, at the core of your heart, there needs to be a change. You don't even need to be angry. You've heard it said this, I'm telling you something different. This is the word become flesh. This is God living out that message that was delivered in a way that only we could see if he put flesh on that gospel and Jesus walked this earth. Concerning adultery, you've heard it said you should not commit adultery, but I say anyone that looks upon a woman with lust has already committed adultery in his heart. So you see the reality of bringing that around to the truth and the core of who we are, the way we promise, the way we retaliate. He says, you've heard it said an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say to you, do not resist an evildoer. It's just an interesting message how he takes and he reshapes that. Because there's a greater truth and a greater message that Jesus is trying to confirm or trying to relay to us. And love of the enemies. You've heard it said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. And so you hear that message and you're like, that's impossible. There's no way that I can do that. And then you get to verse 48. Jesus closes with, they close this chapter. Whoever put the chapter numbers in there, this is where they decided to end chapter 6 with this beautiful phrase. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Okay, could you imagine hearing that? Now, so by show of hands, who in here is perfect? And there's a couple of you, but we'll talk later. Right, so you read that and you're like, dude, I am so toast. How can I live into this? Except for you have to understand not the letter of the law, but the intent of the law. When you go back and you look at that word teleos, it means to mature, which is a process. And so be perfect as God is perfect. So grow in your maturity. Mature as you go through life, as you're learning, it's a transformation word is what it is. As you are learning who God is, that transformation happens. And so maybe today you get angry, maybe tomorrow you don't get angry. Murder is like way off the list. Like can we all agree that we shouldn't murder, right? Like that's we should be able to make it through life without that. But as we start to be transformed, anger is something we can all deal with. Jesus makes it personal for us to recognize that if we truly want to represent God, the change has to be deeper. It's about not just being obedient, but about being and living into what God has called us to live into. And so then we get to chapter 6. 6 minutes, perfect. Chapter 6, remember the key. Chapter 6 goes into those practices. How do you give? How do you pray? How do you fast? What things do you determine to be treasures in life? What are the things that mean something to you? The sound eye, how you view life, what's your perspective in life? Serving two masters, how do you feel about money and how do you feel about life and what's the counterbalance between the two? And then about worrying. When you have an awareness of God in your life, then you understand the difference between being obedient but truly being transformed. You understand what he talks about in chapter 6 when he says, when you pray, don't go pray on a street corner out loud so everybody thinks you're holy. No. You don't pray on a street corner out loud so everybody else thinks you're holy. You pray because that's what we do. We communicate with God. This is not about other people thinking you're holy. This is about truly being holy and posturing our heart in such a way where we spend time with. When you give, don't bang on a gong and let everybody else know what you're giving. No, when you give, we give because it's the heart of God. It's a reflection of the very nature of God, for God so loved this world that he gave. It's an outflow of who we are. You don't give so other people think that you're special or that you're all those different things. We do it because that's God transforming our lives. And that's what he does. The way that we fast, the way that we view life, how much we worry. Some of us, we are so bound up by the way things are in life that we can't even function. Take a deep breath and know that God is engaged. He's aware. What you see going around you is not the kingdom of heaven, but you have something to say about that because you carry inside of you that very life. And as you introduce people, that kingdom starts to grow. It's the kingdom that God grows. And so you get to see that. And so when you understand that key, there's a deeper awareness. Then you move into chapter 7. And he starts off with this topic that, depending on where you are in life, it depends on how you feel about this verse. It's about judging. And so if you've been messing around, you're like, don't judge me. If you're looking at a person that's been messing around, you're like, I got some things I need to tell you, right? Like, you got that? So when you hear this scripture, depending on where you are in life, kind of determines how you read it. But I want you to hear this because this is the process of transformation. He says, do not judge so that you may not be judged. For with judgment you make, you will be judged. And the measure you give will be the measure you get. Why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not notice the log in your own eye? Or how can you say to your neighbor, let me take the speck out of your eye while the log is in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly, and this is the important part, to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. If you do the work in your life to recognize your own sin, then when you encounter somebody else who's broken and dealing with sin in their lives, your feeling towards them is completely different. You don't look at them to judge them. You look at them to help them. Pulling alongside someone and loving them and helping them take the speck out of their eye is different than judging someone. And when you're willing to look at yourself first and allow for that transformation to happen, then you live into this world in a different way. You find yourself living around people that maybe aren't perfect, and you're okay because you've done the work and maybe you have something to be able to help them with. It's a completely different perspective about judgment. And I'm gonna just fly through the rest of this. Ask, seek, and knock. That's our posture in this world. As Christians, we're not called to cower and to hide. I love this because this shows about the heart of God. It's an invitation to be inquisitive, to grow, to experience the things that God wants you to experience, to ask, to seek, to knock, is to push into life, to know the heart of God is not petulant and hateful, but he wants you to enjoy and see all of the best things. The golden rule, treat others as you'd want to be treated. The narrow gate, life is gonna be tough. And then finally, the last two, a tree and its fruit. It's so important. Why would he end with this? Because there are so many people around that look good, but they are rotten to the core. And so he said, be aware, check the fruit, be aware of who it is that's speaking into your life, the person that's got something to say to you, check the fruit. And then finally, he talks about the foundation, hearers and doers of the word. Don't just hear the Sermon on the Mount and walk away, allow it to transform and to change your life. And so thinking about this message and how it hits us, as we were sitting in our men's group, it's hilarious sometimes, we really are proud of ourselves. I love my group. Like, we can have some of the best conversations and we know we're awesome. And so we'll be bloviating about different topics. And as we went through, it got around the corner and Gary on the other side said, well, I'll be honest with you. He said, I don't know whether to love the Sermon on the Mount or be afraid of it. Right? Like, you look at it and you realize how impossible it is to live into the message that Jesus is giving. And so here's what I want you to hear today. And this is the truth. Prior to Jesus, the Israelites were a hot mess. Amen? After Jesus, the church has been a hot mess. Amen? Is it fair to say that? Still have. And here's what I want you to know. There's only one word made flesh that accomplished everything without failing, that did everything the way that the Father asked him to do so that he could fulfill the law. And so when I think about different faith communities that I've been a part of, whether it's a church or a small group or a group, I always know whether I'm in a healthy place by how we view others and how we think about this and how we kind of process through this awareness. If you're in a faith system where you beat yourself up constantly, then you forget that there's only one that's ever going to make it. Do you think it surprises Jesus that you're going to blow it? No. But if you're willing to allow transformation to happen, you may blow it today and tomorrow and the next day, but there will be a time when that transformation will happen and you will continue to grow if you will open up yourself and allow God to do something in your heart. This message is so simple to understand, but so difficult. There's only one for us to believe in and one for us to follow, and it is the image of God, the revealing of his Son, Jesus, in this world. Everything made perfect for us to take and accept as our own, knowing that we're going to fail, knowing that we're going to make mistakes. But when we choose to live into that and those Beatitudes, allowing that transformation to happen, then what happens is we become that salt and we become that light, and God uses us to draw others into this act and this life of transformation. Keep in mind, he's talking to the most broken of the world when he delivers this. Now, is that to say that Jesus wasn't, Jesus was this perfect, easy, when you think about Jesus, he was all the great things that was so attractive about him. He served, he loved, he cared for, he did all of that, but he also flipped over tables and got mad at people. You guys remember that? But do you remember who he got mad at? Always the ones who thought they had it figured out. So just be careful and allow this transformation to happen inside of you. To me, that's the Sermon on the Mount, and that's the transformation that God wants to do. Everybody okay with that? Everybody understand that? Amen. And I think the biggest point is, remember, it starts with Jesus. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we love you. And as we just work through this sermon series, I thank you for your Son, Jesus. Not just obedient every day. He lived into his calling every day. Even the days when it wasn't fun, even the days there were other opportunities to do other things, he lived a sinless life so that we could experience forgiveness, so that we could see a representation of God, of you, God. And so today we start by just being thankful for your Son, Jesus, and for those who haven't had an opportunity to open up your hearts and maybe believe in him today. It's a great opportunity to do that. As God, we just say, start to transform us as we yield ourselves in light of you. Lead us and guide us and help us to be that church that doesn't meet people at the front door by sizing them up, but we meet people at the front door by doing what you did and blessing them and starting to hope and believe in the transformation that will happen. We love you, we trust you, and it's in your Son, Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, as Tammy plays this song, I encourage you to listen to the words. They're powerful, they're meaningful, and they'll get right to the heart of the matter. I'll be down front if there's something that I can pray with you about. I'll be honored to do that this morning.
You came to the world you created, trading your crown for a cross, willingly died, your innocent life paid the cost. Counting your status as nothing, the King of all kings came to serve, washing my feet and covering me with your love. If more of you means less of me, take everything, yes, all of you is all I need. Take everything. You are my life and my treasure, the one that I can't live without. Here at your feet, my desires and dreams are laid down. my desires and dreams I lay down. If more of you means less of me, take everything, all of you is all I need. Take everything, oh Lord, change me like only you can. Here with my heart in your hands, Father, I pray, make me more like Jesus. This world is dying to know who you are. You've shown us the way to your heart. Father, I pray, make me more like Jesus. If more of you is less of me, take everything, yes, all of you is all I need. Take everything.
So let's lean into what it means for us to let go of more of ourselves, to make room for God in our lives and allow His transformation to take over us. Will you guys stand with me as we pray? Father God, we're grateful for the gift that you offer. Lord, the fruits of your Spirit that can turn our lives around. And Lord, I ask that you would help us become aware of the things in our hearts and in our lives that we need to let go of to make room for you. Lord, we invite your transformation into our lives. God, and I ask that you would give us the strength to do so when it's not always easy. But Lord, knowing that you are ultimately worth it. Lord, we love you. We are so grateful for you and that you call us yours. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Have an incredible, beautiful Sunday morning.